Hello.
Yeah. Is it audible to all? Yes. Okay. I'm a Poonam Bidkar. I'm working with Unimity Solutions from last 2 years. I'm a Drupal developer. And you can connect me on Twitter. You can connect me on LinkedIn. And that is my Drupal handler. So in this session, I'm just going to share the experience when we implemented the SSO in the enterprise level. So I just would like to share few lines about my company where I'm working. The Unimity Solutions Private is a software service organization. We are in an IT service from last 25 years. We are in IT services, and we started Drupal from last 10 years. And the company is headed by Mr. J. Krishnan. And we are specialized in Drupal Enterprise Solutions, Drupal Development Services. We have clients across all over the world. And our primary clients are the publishing house in Dubai. And we are committed to giving back to community by organizing programs, workshop, and contributing to a projects or to a modules. So this, we are going to see the SAML and JWT for SSO as a part of enterprise Drupal implementation. So the agenda of the session is, we'll just have a small introduction about the SSO, SAML, JWT, and different types of SAML and JWT implementation in cloud services, real-life scenario of using SSO, advanced type topics like configuration template, authentication method, and meta templates configuration under the SAML, and key challenges we are facing while implementing the SSO with the enterprise solutions, and how to configure the Drupal 8 site both as a service provider as well as an identity provider by using the simple SAML library. So nowadays, if we are building any application for enterprise solutions in a Drupal, so we have to make sure that we have a user experience and the stakeholder experience will be the same as like the other application in that enterprise solutions. To achieve this, we have to implement the SSO, single sign-on. So here is that. So the large enterprise means organization will have a multiple applications. Some of their are own, some of the others, or some of them are their business partners. So in this diagram, we can see it. The SSO, we have a single authorization and authentication system implemented in the center, and user can log into the same system and he can get access to all of the applications. So might be some application will be in another languages, another technology, and some might be in a Drupal. So some of the benefits of SSO, I have just listed here five major benefits of the SSO. Improve user experience through the automatic login. Nowadays, if you are logging to any site, you just need to log in with the Gmail, only one step thing, and you will get automatically log into the all application related to that. Once if you are in a browser, if you log into a Gmail, you will see if you visited any application, it will ask to log in. We have just click and we'll get the access to that application. So that will be the first and very important thing in nowadays market. We have to make sure that our application will be a user friendly, and it will have the user experience for the login process will be quick and simple. So by using the SSO, this we can achieve. The second is the easier account management. Easier account management if we have to log in a multiple applications. So most of the people won't remember the password, like me. I am not able to remember any password. So then we have to check the list of passwords, then we have to enter in the password field. If login get fails, then again we have to check what wrong I have entered in the password field. And if three times if our login fail is exceed more than thrice, then we have to call the help desk and request for the password reset. So that will take at least it will take 5 minutes of the time of the user. So to reduce these things, we have implemented the SSO. So we need to remember only single password, only one password, and it will reduce the chances of forgetting the password. So that will be a easier account management. So you can log into a multiple accounts by using a single password. The third one is to improve the compliance and security. So everyone will think that if I have a single password, so if the password gets stolen, what will happen next? So he can able to access all the application, and that all application will be available for the hackers. They can hack it and they can. So we in SSO, we need to remember a single password, so we can make that password as a strong, so that we can easily encourage the user to use the strong password and make sure that password you should keep as a confidential. And the compliance and security, the SSO will also help to achieve the compliance and security by encouraging the users to use the secure application for transmitting the protected data or the sensitive data across the parties. So you should make sure that you will use the secure channels. And the facilitate B2B collaboration. As I said, the largest enterprise will have a multiple applications. So for as per a user also and as per a developer also, to implement login system in each application, it will be a time consume also, and it will be a tricky thing to implement in all the applications. So to avoid all these things, we have implemented the SSO. So once user get logged into a single site, it will get the access to all the sites. So that is the main thing which is the very important benefits of SSO, which will help in the most of the enterprise solutions and reduces the help desk cost. That is automatically we have a now, because of the sensitive data, all of the companies or all of the sites making the password policies are the strict, means they have minimum you have to enter the 8-character password, including that lowercase, uppercase, now numeric, alphanumeric. So it will be difficult to remember that password. And if a user visited more than 10 sites per day, so he have to remember the 10 password. That is impossible to remember. So all the time he have to call the sir help desk and request for the resetting the password. So that by using the single sign-on, that complete process will be complete, means that process is not required by using the single sign-on. User have to remember a single password, and it will be a less chances to forget the password. So automatically the help desk cost will be reduces. No need to use the second part is real life scenarios. So here I have just listed the basic scenarios where everyone can know about, that everyone can use this. But in this sections, I would like to share the what we have implemented in the enterprise solutions, the SSO. So we a couple of our financial services, we have implemented the SSO, that we have built a centralized system for that is for a content, and we are just sending the content across the portals. And all some of the portals are built in another technology, and some of the portals are built in a Drupal. So throughout the complete the enterprise level, we have to give a same look and feel. So we have integrated with the SSO, that some solutions we have a SSO, as we have they have built the SSO, means authentication authorization, on their server, and we are using that to build a Drupal application. In some of the cases, they have a third party SSO, that is like a Okta, Sentrify, WebEx. So some of like that, so they have implemented, so we have integrated with that and we make it work. And that we have created as a SP and IDP and a both means on the same server. So in that scenario means we have a learning portal site. So in that we have the learning, the courses and all registered in the Totara, and the marketing things we have placed in a Drupal, and as well as we have built a central system, that IDP, to validate the user information. So once user get logged into the IDP, he can access the courses and he can access the Drupal site as well. So, and whatever the permission he have, depend on that, he will get the content over there. So here is the like we have a login to a Gmail system, we can access all the applications. And in the mobile, so if you log in to a Gmail account, we can sync all our photos, data from the Google to your mobile. Now the SAML, Security Assistant Markup Language. So this, the SAML is a XML-based framework. It will help to eliminate the application-specific password for a SSO using in a web browser, and it will have the two types. That means we can configure it as a identity provider, we can now configure as a service provider. So the SAML metadata, that metadata will ensure the transmission of the data between identity provider and the service provider. So identity provider, it will validate the user trying to access the website using SSO. And the service provider will give the access to the web content, or will give the access to the web service. In which terms you are using the identity provider depends on that, we will get the access to the site or the web services, web content. So in identity provider, means in both the IDP and the SP, we have some attribute. The major attribute is the entity ID. So the entity ID attribute will specify the entity of that, means the entity, the application unique ID. For which applications we have to make as an IDP, which application we have to make as a SP, so that entity ID will be common in both, but we have to make, if we have a multiple applications, so each application will have a unique entity ID. And another parameter is the valid UTIL, that is the validity of the metadata, the SAML metadata, expiration of the SAML metadata, that parameter will store. And SAML is a open standard, so it will be easily adopted by, it means we can easily configure it with the Google, Salesforce, Okta or Centrify and WebEx. So from this we did the SSO for Google, Salesforce, Okta and Centrify, as well as WebEx also. So how does the SAML work? So first, once user visited the website, user connects to the service provider to access the application. After that, service provider will delegate the authentication to identity provider, and identity provider will check the user identity with the data, with the identity database. Means we can store the user information like LDAP or Active Directories. So it's depend on the means what we are using. So it will verify the user from the database, and then it will pass the that SAML assertion about the user to the service provider, and user will get access to the application from the service provider. The second part is the JSON web token. Nowadays, most of the application or the webs, the REST thing, we are using a JWT. Even for a single sign-on also, we are using a JWT. So that we are going to see, I'll just, when we are comparing the SAML and JWT, that time I'll just tell you. So what is the JSON web token? JSON web token is also a open standard defined in RFC 7519. Is defined as a compact and self-contained for transmitting the information between two parties as a JSON object. So this information is verified because it is signed by, it is digitally signed. So JSON, it can be signed by using the HMAC algorithm or public or private key pair by using the RSA. So JSON, So where we can use the JSON Web Token? So just previously I told that it will be used in the authentication and information exchange. Authentication is this is the very common scenario where the JWT token, nowadays people are using JSON, JWT. So in authentication, once the user got login, in all the subsequent requests, he will pass the JWT token to the service provider and to the IDP, and it will always verify the token and it will give the access which permits to that token. And information exchange, that whatever the information we have to pass between two parties, that will also happen using a JWT, as JWT having a three pass. It's mainly used in web. Now before that also we are using a token to validate the web services. Most of the time we are using a token that is even not a JWT token, but simply without using the basic authentication, we can use a single token to validate the web services. So that will be a good thing about the JWT. Nowadays, most of the solutions will use the JWT for the web services. The token is composed of the three part: header, payload, and signature. So header will contain it will have a two parts, that is a type of token, that is JWT, and the algorithm used for the signing, that is HS256. And the second part is the payload. Payload is nothing but the claims. That claims means it is the statement about the entity, or the additional information about the entity. So here we have three types of claims, that it will be registered claims, public and private claims. The registered claim is predefined claims. Public is also a predefined, but it's depend on the JWT and the algorithm we are using. And the private claim is the custom claim which we are defining. So as we can see, SUB is the subject and name is the name, and IAT is the issuer at. And the last part is the signature. Signature is the combination of header and payload. So along with that, it will have the hashing algorithm which we are using in a header, as well as the secret. So all combining, if we encode, all will be a base64 encoded and separated by the dots. If we combine it, it will be a JSON web token. As you can see, all is encoded: header, payload, and signature, with the algorithm and the secret. So how does JWT work? The JWT and SAML, if we see, it will work with the same. Only in the SAML, we have a SAML XML data, and JSON, we will have a JSON object. So once user will request to the service or the applications, it will send the authentication details, and the server side, it will verify the authentication detail, and it will create the JWT token, and it will send back to the client. Then client will store, and it will use in the subsequent request. So it will again verify whenever the next request, it will again verify, and it will give the access. If it's a wrong token, it will send as an error, return error. So JWT versus SAML. So as we can see in the diagram, it is not that much clear, but the main purpose of showing this one is that the size of the JWT token and the SAML token, SAML encoded. So the first one is the size, which we are easily, means the JSON is a small size, but with the same information, and authenticator, that SAML is also with the same information, but it's XML, so encoded will be the large amount of data. So, and the second point is the JSON. JSON parser will be common in all the languages, so it is easily acceptable, and we have in JSON directly we can do the object mapping also, but SAML is in XML we cannot do the object mapping, so it is a little bit tricky to use with other applications. So now we here just I'm just giving you the brief things. After that, I'll just show you the code how we can configure the SAML library. So for the JWT, we require this libraries, contributed module. If you are using for the web services, then you can use the JWT module. Or if you want to go for the SSO, then you can use OAuth2 JWT SSO module. That is also, it's not a stable release, but it will work with. And or another way is to implement the SSO by using JWT. We can create a separate instance to validate the informations, and that we have to build with the core PHP by using the JWT libraries. That will also work, and that is also a secure thing. So you can create the keys for the JWT token, that HMAC key and the RSC key pair, by using that commands. This is for the JWT. The second part is the simple SAML PHP library. The first you need to download the library, and you have to configure as a service provider. If you want to do it as a identity provider, then you can create a, say you can use only a simple SAML library, and you can create the application which will validate the user in, user authentication. And the contribute module, that simple SAML PHP auth and external authentication is the dependent module to that. And the certificate and key you can create by using this. So certificate and key is the, means it will be a important part in both the cases, JWT and SAML also, to validate the user, that identity, it will play the major role in that. So this will be the. So now I'm going to show you the how we can configure it. So first part, we have to download the SAML library, and we can use it. So we can use as a, once you implement enable this simple SAML module, then you can, is it not visible? Okay. Control at the end. So if you enable that module, it will ask you to do the composer update for this library. So if you you can use with the in vendor folder also this library, but mostly because this library will have the configuration, means we have to store the SP and the IDP details in this library. We need to edit some files, so it is better, it's always good option to keep it as a separate external library. Because whenever we'll do any updates, the everything will get vanished in the whatever we did in the composer thing. So we have implemented as an external library. So to make it work as an external library, we need to configure the directory path, the simple SAML PHP library. So that is the complete path of this libraries, and we have put the simple SAML folder in the libraries folder. So. And these are the configuration part. Once you enable the module, if you go to the configuration of that module, you can see these things, the simple SAML auth settings. That first one, first you will see the three tabs, that basic setting, local authentication setting, and the user information thing. So that we can set in setting.php, or you can use that module configuration also. The both way it will work. Want to show you. So this will be the library. In the library, we will have so many folders. So where we have to, means which folder we need to set, that only I'm going to show you here. The CERT, that certificate folder, here we have to, that we have, I have shown the command. By using that command, we have created the key and the certificate, and we have stored that certificate in the CERT folder. And the second is the configuration template and the meta templates. Once you paste the library, you will find there will be a two folders, that config-template and metadata-template. So we have to rename it, and we have to add the, we have to just go inside, and we have, you will find more files, but we need to touch only the configuration and the auth source file. In auth source file, this will be the entity ID. what entity we are going to, means if we have a multiple entities, we can just simply define as below, like this, YubiKey, you can use OpenID, Google, like the multiple entity key you can use in this. If you see the module configuration, in module configuration, we have only a single means entity. We can configure with a single entity, but if you use the auth source and if you go to the settings file and you can configure here, you can configure a multiple entities in that. So these are the private key and the certificate which we have created by using that command. So, and the entity ID. So this entity ID will be the where will be the means this is the this entity ID will this is as a our Drupal site. We can mention the Drupal site where we can have the path will be the same. This path will be a same because we have implemented the application in the local root. So if you put the /simple-saml, you can directly have the you can directly see the application. So this will be the path for the application, and this will be the changing as depend on the identity key which you are using here. So and this IDP, that IDP we are using as a Google as a IDP. So we have mentioned the Google account as we have created a key here. This will be the auth part. This much things we have to do. We have to do in the auth configuration. Other file is the config file, which you can find in the config folder. Here is we have to set the base URL, the path that is our SAML application path. If we are having a we are using as a service provider, and so we can use as a /simple-saml, and we have the access of the simple-saml, and we can see there if the connection is means connection with the IDP is working or not. We can see there metadata information of the service provider and the identity provider. So in this, we have to set the that application. This authentication means this auth password is for the SAML application. This secret salt also we have to create the technical contact name. If you are using in a production, then you have to mention the valid name and the email address, because if anything wrong happened, then we will get the mail on this ID. So mostly wrong means if the handshake between the service provider and identity provider having some issues, then we will get information on this. So now we are configuring Drupal as a service provider and Google as the identity provider. So we have to enable this one as a true. The post request and this will be the, if you are using any other, the memcache PHP session, then you have to mention here the memcache or PHP session. We are using MySQL, so I have used SQL here, and the information about the our database. The second part is the metadata. In this, we will find the two files will be there. IDP remote and SP remote. So here we have to set up that this will be the IDP informations. We are using a Google account as the identity provider. So we have a URL of this one, the single sign-on service, and the single logout service that you can use, means once it log out, it will directly redirect to your application. The fingerprint, the certificate key. Here is the SAML 20 SP remote, that is our Drupal application. We have configured Drupal application as a service provider, so we have to mention the URL, assertion custom consumer service, that is the same URL, and single logout service also. After logout from that application, it should redirect to the same. So I'll just show you how it will work. And one more thing we need to set up, if we have in the HT access to access the SAML application, we need to set SAML path here. It will be simple. So this rewrite condition we need to add here in this line so we can easily access this SAML, simple SAML application. I'll just show you how it will work. So it will work. So it will work means here the SSO1 that unimity.com is the service provider. Once we click on the login page, just pause it. Okay, sorry. So once we click on the login page, we'll take you to. So here, it, the SSO login, that button will appear. That configuration we have did in the setting file. That all things will that SSO button that name will be also from the setting files, or we can use the module configuration. There also you can define these things. But if you want to use a multiple identity provider or multiple service provider, then you have to do the configuration in the setting.php. Once you log in, it will redirect to the Google account page. You can use the your account, and once you click, once you enter your password, it will take you back to the Drupal site. So in this, the user, if a new user, if you are logged in without the user, the same user will get created in a Drupal also. That one, only one thing is in a Drupal, means it, if we have a separate database for IDP also, it will create a user at the Drupal end. This will be the thing. So in this we have the challenges we face while integrating with the enterprise level with the Centrify or with the Okta or with the Salesforce or as a custom IDP. That is the handshake between IDP and SP. So most of the time whenever the request sent from the as a Drupal application to the IDP, that time through a load balancer, so it will just remove the, if we have a SSL enabled, just it will remove the, it will send a request as a HTTP and it will read the, it will send the response also as a HTTP. So if we have a SSL enabled, we need to on the reverse proxy at the Drupal end, so it will send the request as a HTTPS and will get the response as well as HTTPS. So that then the connection between the service provider and identity provider will work. If it's HTTP and it's, the response is getting as HTTP, that time also it won't work. So, and the another main important thing is that the parameter which we are defining in the IDP, the same name and the same parameter we have to define at the Drupal end also to do the mapping between the username of the identity provider and the username of the Drupal at the end of Drupal. So that parameter should be a valid and should be a correct at the both end. And the certificate key, that certificate key should be whenever, if you have a multiple application, then each application will have a unique certificate and key that we should that should be a unique, not means that we should not touch that files. And another is the same HTTP and HTTPS. That is the case if we are sending requests through the load balancer and if we are getting the request from the load balancer, that will. And the SAML data is the parameters which we are going to send from the IDP to the SP. So And this, if we have a means, if we can, we have to change the in configuration file the base URL path. Then we can directly we can define in the setting.php file also in the configuration file at the end we can define the path also. If we have a means, if we are using a same library for a multiple applications, means if I have defined a SAML library as a IDP, then I need to use this configuration because from which service provider the request is coming, that I can see in the base URL path that I can configure here. So any questions? Thank you. Yeah, yes. Yeah. Okay, sure.